Welcome everyone to episode 83 of Just Joshing. I am your host, Joshua Pentelaresco. I write stuff and I podcast too. And I got a really cool guest today. I almost want to call this the coming out of the closet episode. It's not true. Katherine Dell is my guest. Katherine is an independent author. She's an independent jeweler. She's an amazing talent. The reason why I say the coming out comment though is one of the things we were talking about early on was, and you'll hear this in the conversation, is, you know, people think I seem to write horror, she said. Okay, I mean, you know, horror is a very subjective thing. But as you hear her talk about her books and her descriptions, you kind of get the impression that it might be more accurate than she's letting on. But that all said, Katherine is actually super cool. She is taking on the plunge of getting into self-publishing. Her book, Harmless, is coming really soon. It's about a girl named Rachel, who's searching her clothes after her brother's tragic death and everything else that's happened in her life. All the while, though, she's coping with the unwitting release of a malevolent spirit that has possessed her friend. To save her friend, Rachel must accept the very thing she's been fighting against, the realization of her own wish. In trying, Rachel could become the very monster she tries to stop. It's a young adult. It's horror. It's romance. It sounds like a really cool book, and I can't wait to read it. And you know what? I'm looking forward to getting right into the conversation. But before I do, I want to remind everybody that May 24th, is my first live podcast. It'll be at Owl's Nest Books. I have 3 confirmed guests in the weeks to come. I will talk about each and every one of them starting next week. One of them I'm looking forward to because I've never actually talked to him on the podcast. The other 2 have been on the podcast. That's all I'm going to say right now. So with that all done, let us go to our kind of conversation with Katherine Dell. Called A Familiar Story Told in a Brand New Way, The Watcher is about a slave boy who kills his dragon masters and goes into a post-apocalyptic wasteland, discovering that there's more to life than being a slave. The Watcher is book 1 of the Watcher saga, which has book 2, Storm Dancer, and the concluding saga, The Wandering God, will be out later this year. It is available at mirrorworldbooks.com, amazon.com.ca, Barnes & Noble, Chapters Indigo, and any other online bookstore you can think of. Okay, so I'm going to turn this on.
Right.
I'm turning this on. So there we go. So anything incriminating you want to say, or you can feel free to say as much as you want. It's all good.
Okay.
So I am with Katherine Dell, who is a jack of all trades, renaissance woman, at least when it comes to the arts. She's actually grinning at me. She's just like, I never thought of it like that.
Okay.
Am I laying it on a little thick?
Perhaps, yes.
Perhaps? Okay, so let's where do you want to talk about first? Your jewelry or your book?
Let's talk about my book.
Okay, so let's talk about your book. You're nearly done.
Yes, it has been several years in the making. Probably about a year and a half ago, I considered self-publishing. I got almost through that process with a bigger self-publishing sort of boutique house. And read the contract more carefully, didn't like a few details, backed out of that. Then I got the interest of a small publisher, and for a few reasons, I had to back out of that one too. Some of them being, I don't know, artistic integrity, maybe I didn't like a few of the changes they wanted to make to my manuscript.
What?
One thing they wanted to do, I won't say the actual publisher's name.
You like your bank account, I totally understand that. Yeah.
No, I had actually backed out of this one as well. But I felt that some of the things they wanted to do might have sanitized the story. And it's young adult fiction, I mean, it's real. One of the things they wanted to take out was the underage drinking. It was an American publisher,
okay.
And I know, okay, drinking age is 21 over there.
Yes.
My story is set in BC, drinking age is 19.
Yes.
But my character is 17, going on 18, last year high school. I really didn't think, I don't know.
Yeah.
I was like, oh yeah, sure, I can take that out. And then I reread my manuscript and I was like, no, each one of these has purpose. You know, this detail is in the story for a reason, and Yeah. So that was about a year ago. And since then, I have been querying, trying to get the interest of another agent to publish my book. But as you saw that joke that I made on my blog earlier, it was an incredibly long process, and I took about a year to do that, and I'm just done. So I'm finally committing, I'm taking the pledge to self-publish. I set up my own publishing house, to which I finally bought the domain name for, so I can tell you what it is. It's called Maroon Vixen.
Maroon Vixen? Maroon Vixen. Why Maroon Vixen?
You know, sometimes names of companies, they just sound cool. They give you a feeling, right? And I wanted to pick a publishing house name that was sort of maybe all-encompassing to the books that I might put out in it. Vixen is, well, that's a term for the name of a female fox, or maybe a woman with, I don't know, strong attitude.
Yes.
And maroon?
Yeah.
I don't know, I just thought that sounded cool.
It's all good. I'm sorry we're talking about this off the air. I'm calling it the Cloud Diver. The name I'm thinking about for my mind is going to be Civilized Savage Production. Two things. One, you get to know me a little bit better. I'm civilized, but there's a little bit of I'm a very blunt, savage kind of dude in some ways. The other thing too, I'm a big Tarzan fan. And I'm doing like a pulpy style story, so it's a nice little homage to look at Tarzan. He was a civilized man, quote unquote, but he was also, but at heart he was a savage. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could fit so many different kinds of books under that publishing title.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So everybody's got their own thinking about that. I'm still kind of thinking about it. But my buddy came up with like a buddy top hat with a Zulu shield, and I'm like, that actually would fit.
Yeah, I haven't designed my logo.
I think you're going to be fine on that, though.
But I'm like, oh, you could do so many things with it.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Like with branding and...
Well, like for you, right? I mean, if you want, depending on which angle you want to go about this, right? You could do like the Vixen, like an actual legit Maroon Vixen with this sort of kind of personality, like thing. Like maybe make her like this fierce, badass warrior chick on each of your spines. You make it depending on the kind of story you're writing too. Something like maybe a little sultrier, because again, you think Vixen, you do think, you know, hot chick. It's just the way it is, but. It could go a variety of different ways. There's like it's a really simple thing. The really key with a good logo is it's got to look almost like an icon.
Yes.
Yeah, it's almost got to look like an icon. But if it looks like an icon, right, you can put it anywhere. Right? It's either that or I have to put the unicorn that farts rainbows thing. That was nuts. So my sister requested in the story that I have a unicorn that farts rainbows in it.
I remember that post, yes.
That post made, I couldn't believe how many people played along with that. That blew my mind.
What was mine? I said Connie.
Yeah, you actually had a serious consideration. You were the first woman. Sarah Johnson actually agreed with you.
Yes.
Yes. Although she wants Andrew Lloyd Webber, so.
Oh.
but the thing is, I really stumbled onto something there, because ever since that, I have that post, I have been retweeted, I have been, a lot more people have been paying attention to what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, right? But ever since I did that, I was just like, so maybe what I should do, maybe on the back of the book, is just have like a little unicorn that parts some kind of rainbow or something. I don't know.
You know, I think maybe it's just because you're making social media social.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a flashing billboard ad. It's a water cooler in the break room.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You got to have fun, right? You got to have fun. So.
And I think some people forget that. Like, I mean, as an author, yes, I want to advertise my books. I want to say, buy my stuff, read my book, whatever. But it's so impersonal. And... Well,
yeah, no, it really is. I it's hard for me now because I shill so many other people's stuff, and I say that the wrong word. I'm as much a fan as I am an author, and because of that, I mean, because I've had the opportunity to interview so many people that are wonderful, you included, right? And yes, right. that I kind of like, it's weird because it's easy for me now to push somebody else. It's hard for me to sell my stuff now, if that makes sense. Right? It's like I do stuff too, but I forget about that. It's easy for me to talk about you or Adam Dries or Randy McCharles or somebody else. It's just easier for me. Maybe it's a weird...
But, you know, you're also building relationships with those people, and those people will remember you and how you help them out. Like, a lot on my website, too, is interviews with other authors, and I used to do guest blog posts, things like that. I've stopped doing the guest blog posts because I got burned once. Because some people would provide me with images that I'd stick on my website, and, you know, perhaps I'm a little bit too trusting a soul sometimes, and I saw this image, and it was a good image. And I was like, oh, that's really funny, I like that, but it just seemed to me that the person who sent it to me didn't have a right to that image. She's like, no, it's good. Okay. Anyway, the image police did track me down later, and I had to pay a fine and take it off my website. It's all good now.
There.
Anyway, I've learned.
Yeah, I see. I see. No, I wow. I'm gonna.
They will find you.
They will find me. And they
if
will
you
be...
use their picture. Okay.
Okay. I gotta be good now. I found a really fun game over. I almost used a Pac-Man thing last night for the most recent vlog I just did. I said, no, I better not. Mm-hmm. Nintendo might beat me. They have a bigger pocketbook than I do, and I'd rather not, you know.
No, just don't go there.
Yeah,
don't do it.
No, don't. Don't go there. Pac-Man's so fun, but no.
No.
Okay, so you do interviews yourself, or you have done interviews yourself. Who's been your favorite interview so far? Or am I making you pick children?
It's making me pick children. Some of my favorite authors, maybe the ones that I know the best. Adam Dries, we're good friends. Kathy Armstrong. Who else? I have so many on there. You know, I looked on my website the other day, and I think I have over 100 blog posts. I mean, some of those blog posts, some of those interviews. So it's kind of hard for me to pick. Maybe those are the more recent ones that I'm thinking off the top of my head.
No, it's fine. Like, I mean, there are. I have three on my all-time list. Rob Osborne, he's an artist based out of Arizona, as his character, Mr. Zango. It was fun. That's a really fun night. It was just a fun take on an interview I've never done before. Asia Alpazi, she's a manga artist based out of England. And most recently for the podcast, Adam actually is also one of my favorite interviews too.
Yes, he's a great speaker.
He's a good speaker, but we talked like for like a half hour after the interview was done. He's a really cool dude. So it's just like those are the three. And I have to mention honorable mention of Simon Rose. He changed my interview style actually.
Yes, I met him at what is that called? When Words Collide.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Don't know if he remembers me. Hi, Simon.
Hi, Mr. Simon. I gotta get him back on the podcast at some point. So going back on, rearranging the track here, like I said, we go over it twice. So you tried doing it being published before going on your own. Is there like a particular reason? Because the reason I'm asking is at this point, it's easy now almost to put together something. Like, you know what I mean? It in terms of presentation, in terms of, making something look very professional, it's a lot. The tools are there for anybody to do that now.
I am very lucky for having my stuff, I think, look very professional. I used to be an executive assistant for a media company.
Oh, okay.
So my website, my book design, my branding, all of these are done by my wonderful friends who I used to work with at this media company. Some of them own their own media website type businesses, some of them just still work in that type of industry, but you know, I've kept in touch over the years, and I don't know, they believe in my project, they believe in my story.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah,
no, it's really cool. No, it just, I mean, but the reason I say this is you said you were going for a more traditional route when you started.
Yeah.
So why the more traditional route at the beginning, and why take the plunge now? Why, other than you've lost your patience with the traditional route?
I've lost my patience with the traditional route, definitely. I'm not saying I wouldn't want to go that way in the future, but it was more feedback from some of my better readers that they're like, you know, hold out. There's sort of this, there can be a stigma about self-publishing. I think the industry is really changing, and it's different now. But I kind of wanted that validation of traditional publishing. Like, someone thought I was good enough to put the money and the effort into me, you know, as validation for my own self and writing. But now that I've met this whole community in Calgary, the writing community here is so welcoming. And so many people are helping me out.
Yes.
That, I don't know, I think self-publishing will be very rewarding. And I think to the average reader, I don't think anyone will be able to tell.
That's sort of like what I'm saying. Like, there are still some books that you can tell are you can tell. But some books, like in terms of production values, in terms of
editing,
things like that, they're on par, if not better, than what you see in a traditional house sometimes.
I totally agree.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of my favorite, I love his Wizard Killer covers. Like, they're fantastic, because they're very eye-catching. There's something you'd see on a mainstream book. It kind of reminded me, I didn't want to tell him this, was a young adult line James Patterson did way back in the day. They're almost the exact same style. It's like, this will grab people.
Mm-hmm.
And I just saw that when I looked at his stuff. And the other thing, too, is you can almost do, like the Cloud Diver, like my book is Indiana Jones meets the Matrix.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's my pitch with it. And so I want to do like an old school pulp style cover design with it. And the thing is, I can, because I have all this reference material from the old Dell covers. I don't know how much reading you did as a of the older stuff you've done when you were younger. But I love some of the...
Dell, you mean Dell Comics?
Like Dell Publishing back in the day, Dell Comics as well too, yeah.
Right.
Some of the really old stuff. They're just really cool covers.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, comics books, I've more recently gotten into, but I'd say my kids are into it. I was telling you before we got recording that it's a treat to take my boys to the comic book shop, and we go down into Kensington, another dimension.
Yes, sorry, I just was, so.
Yeah.
Yes. I play Words with Friends with John, the guy who owns the store. So.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I kiss my butt all the time.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I live way out in the burbs, so I really like to take my kids down into sort of the heart of downtown. I guess Kensington's not downtown, but it really has a cool feel to it.
Actually, they're my favorite two spots in the city.
Yeah.
Like honestly, Kensington, I used to live once upon a time, long, long ago, first time I lived in Calgary. This is technically my second time. But the first time I lived there, I lived in Kensington. Love that area. It's really, really, again, because it's unique. It doesn't feel like any other part of the city. The only other parts of the city that have that vibe are Inglewood. But Inglewood feels older. Like, you're like, oh, I'm not saying, it's just like older money, it's an older place, you can kind of tell. And 17th Avenue has that feel to some extent as well.
A little,
but not, it's not the same. Kensington's kind of like this one of a kind, eclectic place. It's also got the best hot chocolate in the universe.
Where is that? Higher Ground?
No.
No?
No, there's a hot chocolate place literally down on 10th Street. It's called, I can't remember the name, but it's literally on the right side. It's a hot chocolate and they use turmeric. They use turmeric.
Really?
Yeah, no, it's really good. Turmeric, they use, I have them use vanilla.
Mm-hmm.
Right? They use caramel, I change it to vanilla. And then I add black pepper.
Oh, okay. Is it like super yellow?
No.
Turmeric?
No. No, actually, no, it's not.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. No, it adds a spice to the chocolate. It's really, really good. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah. But,
you know, we were talking about book covers before.
Yes.
And I told you mine is sort of 90% done. I have it on my Facebook header and my Twitter header and things like that. I'm tweaking a few things because I noticed when I put it into the really small size, you can no longer read the title or my name.
That's important.
But I've gotten some feedback on it. Some people love it. Some people don't. I'm sticking with it anyway.
Listen, the important thing is that do people notice it? Like that's the real question, right? Because some people will love, like, in a perfect world, we would love to please everybody. And don't get me wrong, maybe one day, like, I will be talking to you, and you'll be the next J.K. Rowling. You'll be like...
In a perfect world,
In
yes.
a perfect world, absolutely. But even she didn't happen overnight. Like, that took some time even with her. But also even along those lines, right, you don't appeal to everybody right away. What happens is you find, like, whatever your niche is, like, you're a young adult.
Yeah.
So 14 and up, considering what we talked about.
Yeah, it's a little more mature, so 14 and up.
So 14 and up. Fantasy, science fiction, real, like romance, like what?
Magical realism.
Okay.
I've been told by some of my readers this is a little bit of horror. Splash of romance to keep it interesting.
Actually, horror and young adult go together really, really well. I don't know why, but they do.
When my beta readers told me that, I was like, horror? Normal people don't write horror novels. I consider myself, you know, a functioning member of society. Maybe it is horror.
I hate to break this to you. Just look around what's considered normal in society these days. I get exposed to a lot of things because I do these podcasts. And I'm not talking about my guests. I just see a lot of different things. So then I go and I look and... There are some people legitimately I look at and I go, how do you function? I I'm sorry, that might seem really cold, but it's just like, I just see them, I just see how they approach things. And I'm like, how? I just can't fathom it, like, in one sense. But in the other, like, I'm open mind up to go, it works for you. And that's great. And, you know, I'm glad it reaffirms my faith that there is a God. Because somebody's taking care of you. Somebody has to be taking care of you. It's kind of... She's trying not to laugh at that, but I mean, it's okay. We're terrible people. It's all good. But I'm terrible. I'm admittedly a terrible person. But normal doesn't. I lived in the Mormon community for 2 years, and I came out. I just threw out the whole concept of normal. Mm-hmm. I'm happier, but I see now more things than I ever saw before, and I'm like, what happened? Oh, I accepted. No paradigm. It's like, except there's no paradigm, I get no paradigm. Everybody's just a little different. Everybody's just, and that's cool.
You know, a little weird makes you interesting.
Absolutely.
I have so many friends that are a little interesting.
That's a good descriptive. You should actually keep that for a book somewhere.
A lot of them are writers too.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, my one friend, I told him, I think I read it on the internet or something, one of those memes or memes. How do you say that?
Yeah, memes.
Memes, okay. Yeah. And it was, you know, your parents gave you just enough dysfunction to make you interesting. That's me. That's a lot of my friends. Enough dysfunction to make us interesting.
Exactly. Well, honestly, no one's got it all right. And I don't think that's the point. I think the point is, you know, I think the point is to go out there and just, you grow as a person with what you experience. And hopefully you build yourself up in a way that doesn't have too many self-destructive impulses. That's it.
Well, you know, with this book, I'm actually interested in how some of my friends and stuff will react to it. I mean, I'm not saying it's very controversial, but I grew up in a very religious background, Roman Catholic. My dad was Southern Baptist. I did much missions work when I was younger.
Really?
I'm not a very religious person anymore, though.
No, it's fine.
but maybe my book has a few more open thinking, newer type ideas in it. And let's say it. That's the PC way of saying it.
That's okay.
And I'm wondering if some of my old school friends would be like, man, I thought I knew you.
It's okay. I have a scene in my current book that I know is going to make people... Someone tried to blackmail me.
Like in real life,
tried to blackmail me.
Oh.
Yeah. It's okay. They picked the wrong person. I'm literally the most guiltless person in the world, or one of the most guiltless people. If I did it, I'm not going to bullshit. I'm just like, hey, I screwed up. I'm stupid. Let's move on. That's pretty much it. So there's a scene where I introduce this character that actually does the blackmail she tried to do to me.
Oh.
Well, you know, okay, but she does it smarter than she did.
So you place a lot of yourself in your books, too. I think...
Yeah, absolutely.
I think the people who know me that read this, too, will be like, oh, that's you. It's a Kathy-ism.
No, it's true, though. I mean, look, I got better with writing when I stopped trying to write just from my head.
Yeah.
The moment I stopped that and I actually just focused on everything, my experiences, it added something really real to the story that wasn't there before. And the moment that happens, I'm not going to say I'm good, because we all kind of have our own...
But you're learning. You're always getting better at it, right?
Exactly. And that's the thing, right? That's when I got to the point where I went from... My friends will read this and like it, and because it's like, there, Josh, you're awesome, too. People will actually like read and respect because it's something that really resonates with me.
Strangers will read it.
Yes, exactly. Right. Exactly. And they will get the impression like, oh, this is really good, right? But that line is putting your own experiences in. I want to read your book now because I have a feeling there might be a few road stories in there. Or are there?
In my book? Yeah. Oh, okay. A few of my stories. Some of them are just my sayings and the isms. Apparently the way I talk and the things I say that I don't realize I say. Mm-hmm. Anyway. My one friend told me it was really colloquial.
That one?
She's Australian. Colloquial?
Colloquial?
She's Australian.
Nice.
Perhaps I say a couple times in the book. I don't know.
It's okay. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong.
It is set in British Columbia, so it's a bit of Canadiana too. Yeah,
nothing wrong with that. So, I guess let's get to a hard question.
What?
Your elevator pitch. What's your 30-second pitch about the book? Uh-oh. Dun, dun,
dun. Okay. I'm being recorded. 30-second pitch.
So, it's okay. It's not 30 seconds. I'm just.
It's longer than 30 seconds.
It's okay. It's longer. It's all good.
All right. My main character, Rachel Barnes, is this sort of disconnected high school student. And she has just recently had, you know, the tragic death of her brother, her parents divorced. Now she's moving from the big city to this teeny little small town with her mother. And having moved, she has to move away from her trusted therapist that she's trying to deal with all this stuff, too. She ends up in a small little town. You know, the roller coaster of her life should be slowing down now when, you know, the unthinkable happens. She unwittingly releases this, like, malevolent spirit who possesses one of her best friends, and she's sort of dealing with her own inner demons while trying to see how far she would go to actually save her friend.
It is horror.
Well, it's
it's demonic possession is kind of, I'm sorry, it does go into the horror trope a little bit. I'm not saying it's like a perfect horror story. I'm not saying you're going for the scares per se, but yeah, it's horror. It's okay.
Okay.
It's okay. Okay. It's okay.
All right. Okay. Well, the cover of the book looks like a horror book too, so I guess it's fitting into its genre.
So for making you come out of the closet, you're a horror writer?
Probably.
A young adult horror writer. Honestly, it goes together really well. Like people forget it. Grim fairy tales are for children.
It is a bit of a grim fairy tale because it has some native folklore in it. It's very inspired by the Wendigo.
Okay.
Do you know what that is?
I do, yeah.
Okay, yeah, a bit of Canadian folklore. Now, the folklore doesn't specifically come from that area of Canada, but I took a few things and sort of created my own legend out of it. To back it up a bit. The Wendigo.
Mm-hmm.
True history in Canada was, just like in the southern states they had witch hunts, in Canada they had Wendigo hunts. It was called Wendigo Syndrome.
Okay.
So what that was, Canada is bitterly cold in the winter, people were trying to settle it, and people resorted to cannibalism. Now, I would just like to state that there's no cannibalism in my book.
Just have to ask that question, but that's good.
Okay.
You're not a horror writer. Okay, gotcha.
No cannibalism. Nobody eats anybody.
That's right, Boris. We talk about, there's possessions, there's terrible things, but no cannibalism. No cannibals were harmed in making
moves. You draw the line. Okay, so the natives in Canada believed that there was like an evil Wendigo spirit that possessed people to eat other people. But the white settlers, who were these Wendigo hunters, believed it was like this Wendigo syndrome, and they would hunt them and kill them. So I'm taking the more Native American approach to it and being like, it is an evil spirit that has possessed this person but can be cured of it.
Again, I have a question I'm going to ask you after the podcast. I'm actually a little curious to that. So
okay.
It won't hurt. I promise. You just made me want to ask this about you. You've gone on mission trips and stuff like that, and I'm just curious about some of the things you've seen
Have I seen exorcisms and stuff?
Ghosts? Yes. Okay. I'll say this. My parents were missionaries once upon a time, but they weren't traveling as much. They were because they had the family and kids. But I remember, they both have told me stories of them actually dealing with demonic possessions in just the town next door where I used to live.
Oh, that stuff's real. Yeah. You know what's one movie that I cannot watch? Like, I do like horror movies, like scary stuff. The Exorcist. You know, I've tried to watch that thing like half a dozen times, and I can't get past like the first 5 minutes.
Because anyone, okay, so whether you believe this or not, folks, this is how this works. Once you see it, you can't unsee it. And once you can't unsee it, right, you can't look at the world the same way. You just can't. It's just the way it is. And that's pretty much one of the things I want to ask. It's like, because, again, I've seen other things, not that, but my parents. I remember Dad told me a story. In the house they stayed at, literally, they were surrounded by shadows, and they were not human ones. So
when I was, what was this? Maybe in high school, at my friend Sarah's house. She lived in this little town, southern Alberta, and it was just one night, regular night. I'm hanging out at her house. It was me and her mom, and she had the kitchen in their house was like. You know, it flowed into the living room, sort of one room.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the kitchen getting something, and they were both sitting on the couch in the living room, so I could see them. We could all see each other. And they had this garbage can in the kitchen with one of those round lids that a regular garbage can. And it, like, picked up and flew across the room and almost hit them both in the head. Nobody was by the garbage can. And they were like, oh, yeah, that's just the ghost. And it ended up that, I guess, before they bought the house, they found out that a guy had unfortunately, sadly, committed suicide. He was a bit of an angry ghost.
Okay,
I
have an interesting ghost story, but that's okay. But not again, not me directly. My one buddy actually, he dabbled. And that I'm not gonna go into too many details. I found out how he dabbled one day. Literally, I come into his bedroom. I literally see a beam of light around his bed. I'm like, I actually asked him, I was like, who's been practicing in here? Because it's one of those things. Wow, I didn't think we'd go here on the podcast, but that's okay.
I think there's many things out there that we don't understand, and that also because we don't understand that we shouldn't mess with them.
I agree. I just the world's a bigger place than a lot of people give it credit for. It's a bigger place, and there are mysteries unto mysteries unto mysteries. And for all the knowledge we have today, sometimes there's the wisdom to actually and still enjoy a mystery, like the actual fact that there are mysteries and there are bigger things out there, that has faded a lot.
Like,
and
not everything's been discovered.
Oh, no. No, I think much like everything else, like the more you actually go, like the more you see, the more you realize there's just so much more you don't know. And I think that's great, because that means no matter, like I said, it's not about getting it all right, it's about how far you can grow before somebody goes... Yeah. So anyway, we went some interesting territory there. It was okay. I didn't expect to go there either. But
well, sort of veering off track, but
no, it's okay.
Not really. Part of the folklore and true history, I like to put a lot of true details into my writing because, I mean, magical realism, it's more believable, right?
Absolutely.
Just like you put your own things in your life into your story becomes more believable. So in this small town, in BC that my story is centered in, there are these, they call them spirit animals, spirit bears. Have you ever heard of that?
I've heard of it, but I don't actually know the full detail about that.
So they're black bears. They're not albino, okay. But they're born white.
Interesting.
And, you know, in all animals, like deer, crows, buffalo, and many others, there's sort of a genetic trait that if one is born white, sometimes native people take it as omen, good, bad, whatever. So yeah, in Canada, this is the highest population of these white bears. They actually have one at the Calgary Zoo.
Nice.
You should go see it.
I should. We're so good for the moment.
Thanks.
It's okay. It happens every time I do an interview here, something like this. Sometimes it's interesting, but you know,
that's right. Is,
yeah.
Makes it more real. Getting coffee in restaurants.
Getting coffee in restaurants and talking about black bears and I should go see the zoo. I have not been to the zoo in Calgary yet.
What? Really?
No, I lived in Toronto. So I went to the Toronto Zoo and every time I've gone to the zoo ever since. I should go. I really should. Just like at first, when I first came here, I lived in Calgary twice, 2003 to 2005 with my dad. It was a love-hate relationship. I liked the city. My dad hated it. I understand why he hated it, but it just, but when you live with that, it's kind of hard to really enjoy the whole city. And ever since I've been back, I've been caught up with just getting my own stuff going. So I haven't had, like, this last year I realized I got to make more time and enjoy some of the things. So it's kind of on my, it's on my to-do list, but it's like, you know, time.
I used to have a love-hate relationship with this city too. I absolutely love Calgary now, which is weird because, well, I've been back for almost 6 years now.
Okay.
We moved to Medicine Hat for 3.5 years.
Okay.
Before that, we'd lived in Calgary for 7 years. But we sort of lived in the northeast, Coventry Hills.
Okay.
And, you know, the different neighborhoods in Calgary really make a difference. There's totally different vibes.
Absolutely.
And we did not like living over there.
No, it's...
But it was what we could afford. It was our first house and...
No, it's... The only thing I don't like about the city, like, the legit, I like the city, I don't love the city. But the only thing I really don't like, it's so hard for people to come here. Like, to actually get started here, it's like...
It's super expensive.
Yeah, absolutely. And for, yeah. for nothing, in some cases. Like, for nothing. And that's... Hi. Anyways, but that's the issue with it, right? It's just, like, the first 3 months here are super hard. If you can make it through that, fine. You just gotta get through that.
Yeah, when I first moved here, I was totally broke. I grew up in Lethbridge.
Okay.
And I moved here when I was 21. I got my coaching certificates in English and Western in Edmonton. I was a riding instructor.
Awesome.
I've done everything.
No, it's good though. It's good. See me, I'm from Oshawa, Ontario. But I lived in Windsor, Detroit, Toronto, London, Phoenix, here. A lot of little towns in all over the place too. And I've done, and you go out, you just do different things, and it adds to you, you grow.
I have so many different interests. It's really hard for me to pick and...
But that's good though, because there are interests, and then there's your passion. Right. Your interests feed your passions. Just that's how it works. And one, but you can't have, you can't have one without the other. And I'm hoping that I'm interested in life until I'm 80, because there's too much stuff to do.
Yes, there is too much stuff to do. Exactly.
So we should talk about your art stuff, like your necklaces and things like that, before we wrap this up real quick. So we'll talk about them.
All right, well, because I don't have enough going on or enough to do, I decided to start an Etsy shop. So what it is, I've made these beaded bracelets for a couple years. My friends are really liking them. You know, I give them away as Christmas presents, birthday gifts, things like that. I'm like, well, you know, other than writing my book, I'm a stay-at-home mom. I stay with my kids. I'm like, well, why not put this out there? My friends really like it. I like being creative. You know, if it wasn't like drawing and art, it's making jewelry or pretty things. Anyway, so I have my beaded bracelets, which are all sort of semi-precious natural stones. And they all have lava rocks on them, which are porous. So I like to scent them with essential oils.
Nice.
So like aromatherapy you can wear on your wrist.
No, it's really good. What do you use? What do you generally use with the oil? Which one do you generally go with?
My favorite is Bergamot.
Okay.
You know what that is? Like Earl Grey tea?
Yeah.
Yeah.
For you, currently right now, you should do like a combination of a drop of lemon with peppermint.
Lemon and peppermint.
The reason being is since you're recovering from pneumonia, peppermint opens up the nasal cavities and makes you breathe easier. It actually sponges oxygen. The lemon will actually go in there and clear any impurities out. But he hasn't been doing this stuff for about 40 years.
Yes, okay. So Josh is the one that recommended, because we were talking weeks ago about me coming on this podcast and stuff like that, and I'm like, oh, I can't come on yet. I still have a fever because I'm really sick from pneumonia. To which he suggested that I put vinegar all over, and I had a good laugh about that because I thought I would smell like a menthol vinaigrette.
Did you try it?
No.
You said that. A true story. So a buddy of mine had this bad flu, and he was like red, like completely like red. So he tried everything. He couldn't get this flu out. So I was like, can I just like... He's terrified of the alternative health stuff. Like, he's absolutely terrified of it.
Mm-hmm.
But he's like, I'll do anything. So I took the vinegar. I took white vinegar. I took water. I dabbed it. He literally went back to his natural skin color in 2 minutes. Like, it completely killed the food.
Oh, no. I totally believe that works. Yeah. I'm totally into the essential oils.
Yeah. But no, for you, like, peppermint and lemon for right now for you would actually do you some good.
Okay.
Yeah. So...
Back to the jewelry.
Yeah, to the jewelry. Yeah. Sorry. I'm sorry.
No, it's cool. I always get off track like that. So yeah, the bracelets. I also have necklaces and bookmarks, which I make out of glass tile. And I source the images on the back. Right now, there's a few sources that I buy them from, but I'm planning to theme some of the bookmarks and jewelry to my upcoming books that are coming out as well.
Awesome.
Merchandising.
It's good though. I actually should be advertising my podcast when I have like t-shirts, cups, and stuff like that too. Why not? Right?
Yep.
Why not? But real quick here, one last. So you said you do drawings and stuff. So have you done any of your drawings and stuff like that on any of your like bookmarks, any of that stuff?
I haven't, but a lot of my friends say that I should. One of the things that I really used to like to draw is like from vintage photographs,
okay.
Like from the 30s and 40s and stuff.
Awesome.
Like that. My mom and my aunts and uncles and stuff, they collected a lot of these photos. I mean, they came over on the boat after the war, and a lot of them are just really cool. They're from all sorts of parts of the world and stuff like that, and I do realistic pencil drawings.
Awesome. You really should. Like seriously.
So I can shrink them down and put them on bookmarks or necklaces or...
No, you should. If you got like
yeah, if you'd like.
Yes. So no, if you have that kind of talent, like I'm envious of drawing. Like my stick figures revolt. Like that's how bad I'm not. I just don't have the coordination to draw. Something is actually a personal goal at some point is I'm actually getting to the point where I get to the point of drawing so I'm at least competent at it. Because I hate to say I'm a comic writer at heart. Right? That's what I am. And it's okay. It was one day. Like I said, remember what we were talking about earlier about the functioning part of life? That's why. But to go back to this, if you've got that kind of talent, like, I mean, and if you're confident enough to actually show your talent, I mean, you should. And that's a heck of a way to do it.
Well, people have asked me, you know, why don't you do your covers and stuff? And as a side project to this, I really wanted to do, like, this book series, Harmless is what it's called, is a 3-book series. It'll be Harmless, Mavens, and Tempest. But I wanted to do prequels in graphic novel form, and my friends are like, well, why don't you draw that? And I don't know. I just love my artist so much.
No, it's fair. No,
she's faster at it and probably better.
That's okay.
And at least I can tell her, like, you know, oh, I like this kind of style. Ooh, do a little more like this. Or
well, it's funny because I work with different artists too. I don't. I'm smart enough to get out of their way when it actually comes to putting the work together, but I'm savvy enough sometimes to make a suggestion here and there because because I do have, like, I've done magazine design, I've done design stuff, so I can look at a cover and go, okay, why don't we do it, let's move the image stuff here and here sometimes, Sometimes. I don't do it all the time, because if it's really good, why would I mess with it?
But I'm good at making suggestion too. I'm good at knowing what I want. I'm just not good at producing what I want.
Okay.
But, you know what's one thing I've found really difficult about trying to write a graphic novel was, you know, you can go to a class and they will teach you how to write a story and, you know, beginning, middle, end, or this is how a story flows, or like basic like that. But for graphic novel, what I found really difficult is 50% of your story is told in pictures.
Absolutely. No.
So you can't write that part.
Yes, actually you...
Or you could, or...
No. You can. There actually is a method to it. I'll tell you the biggest challenge of writing a comic. Like, literally, the biggest thing you have to do in a comic book is try to create the illusion of motion. Because what you're doing, that's
like
the
time passing.
No, that's it. No? Yeah, you're right. Oh, okay. You're right. Right, yes, exactly. That's it. You want to create the illusion of motion, because these are still images. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to get from a certain point to a certain point in a way that sucks the reader in. And there's all kinds of little tricks you can do. Sometimes you can do a good comic with just pictures. You don't need words. It's something I've realized, but you can also like write a script. I have a script. If you'd like, I'll give it to you when it's over. But give it as an example. How to do it in a way that gives the artist input. You should always let your people be creative. If you're not, you're an idiot. But you can convey your story, and there's all kinds of like little tricks you can do, and you can write literally how like what you want in a scene. It's almost like being your director. Say, like, okay, so I want this.
That's like what angle? Yeah, no, zooming in.
Yeah, exactly. No, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
So when you're writing a comic book or a proper script, that's usually how it's done. Right? And by the way.
Sorry, I'm a hand talker. No one can see this on radio.
That's okay. I'm a hand talker too. It's all good. You're gonna wonder what the heck that banging was earlier when I was doing it. But it's okay. But it's just there's a method to it. I think we have most of the good here. I just have one last question for you then.
Thank you.
Yes. But my last question is, you are somebody that has the pursuit of a variety of interests. I mean, you were talking about earlier about me wanting to show you how this wonderful podcast deal works, but you seem to be constantly pursuing different artistic endeavors. So my question to you is why?
Why?
Yes, I have a theory, but I'm gonna let's see what your answer is.
Why am I constantly pursuing artistic endeavors?
Well, different mediums, more specifically.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, not really. I mean, my one medium is my book.
Your one medium is your book, but you have to do jewelry.
Yeah.
You do pictures.
No.
Well, you do draw.
Oh, I haven't in years.
Oh, sad.
I used to. No, I do the jewelry.
Yeah.
And I do my writing.
Yeah.
And I hope to somehow learn to write a good graphic novel.
Okay.
But I don't know, I guess my challenge is focusing, definitely, which in self-publishing I find difficult because you have to run every aspect of it. I have to talk to my editor and my cover designer and the people who does my branding and my website, although I'm learning to do a lot of the website stuff myself.
The more you can do yourself, the better. If you actually become a more skilled person, the downside is your time just goes down the toilet.
I know, you gotta really protect your writing time, which is difficult, especially since I have two little ones too. So
you're tough as nails to boot. Your parent, how old?
I'm stubborn. How old am I?
No, your kids.
My kids are 7 and 8.
Oh God.
Yeah, I don't know what I was thinking there.
Yeah. I know what you probably were thinking at the time, and now you're like, I don't sleep, I have no nap time, nothing, and yet when they have recess, you need recess.
Yeah, actually this is just starting in September, and now they're grade 1 and grade 3, so I finally have some time to myself to pursue this.
Awesome. All right, so I think we got a wonderful interview here. I think so. I could be wrong, but I think we do. So okay. People want to find you. We'll do it this way. What's your book called, real quick, then how people can find you.
Okay. My book is called Harmless. You can find me on Twitter, Facebook. I have a personal profile on there and my page.
My website is katherinedell.com. My Etsy site is kdelldesigns.etsy.com. I guess those are the spots.
Okay, what's your Twitter handle? Next, what's your Twitter handle?
At Katherine Dell underscore Dell.
Okay, fair enough.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, was Katherine Dell. I want to thank Katherine very much for being part of the show. Check out her book, Harmless, when it comes out, and check out her jewelry. It's really cool stuff. Like I said, she was really fun to talk to. We went in a couple areas I never expected to. And yes, like I said, listen to this interview. She definitely is a horror writer, and she's a good, but she sounds like she's going to be great, and I for one can't wait to read the book. And all right, and this will do it for another episode of Just Joshing. I am Joshua Pentel-Rosco. You can support this podcast by doing a few things. You can buy my books, The Watcher, which is now available for 99 cents at mirrorworldbooks.com, or you can get it at amazon.com. Storm Dancer's book 2. You don't need to read book 1 to read book 2, but they kind of go like peanut butter and jelly. You should pick them up there as ebooks. They're $99 and $2.99, and for regular books, they are $10 and $12 a piece. You can also join my newsletter, tinyletter.com/jpantaleresco, JPANTALLERESCO. You can subscribe to the podcast either on Podomatic or on iTunes. It's available there. But whatever you do, whatever passions you have, stay inspired out there. All right? All right. See you next time.
Josh. Josh.